Hello, you malty match hoes. Yes, Ralphie here with Whiskey Review 348 and a big malt, merry malt mention to Vartan, who supplied our malt mention for Whiskey Review 348, which is part of a mini series on Irish whiskies in the run up to St. Patrick's Day 2013. So there we go. Here's an unusual one. You don't see so much of this, but a very interesting Irish whisky. It's called Knappogue Castle. That's Knappogue with a K, as in knickers with a K. It's a silent K. Really like the colour. See how light it is? Absolutely no reason why a light colour should ever put anybody off buying a whisky, because with a little bit of experience we soon find out that the colour of a whisky has very little bearing on what the flavour may be, the intensity and the strength of the flavour. And that's what you find with Laphroaig, for example. But back to this particular fine specimen here. This is Knappogue Castle, an independent bottling of Bushmills. Now, the observant amongst you will have noticed my mighty malt blooper in Whiskey Review 347, when I did state quite clearly that Bushmills was a double distilled whisky. It's not, and thank goodness for people like Shoeboy05, who just says, "Oi, Ralphie, triple distilled at Bushmills." And I should have checked the official website, because it does state it there, and it also states on the bottles of Bushmills. But I had it in my head from a conversation way back when, in the mists of time, that Bushmills was double distilled, and it's not. So there you are, triple distilled whisky. You don't get many independent bottlings of Bushmills. They are as rare as hen's teeth, because the owners, Diageo, and I quite understand what they're doing, they're wanting to protect the reputation of their brand, and therefore they basically are very, very particular about who they would sell casks to. And what's interesting about this is it's a naked Bushmills. It's a very raw Bushmills. This particular vintage is the 1994, bottled at 40%. And your initial contact with it is, you know, oh my goodness, what on earth is going on here? Because let's just bear in mind that when you get official bottlings of a whisky, they're very much a blend of single malt in order to get a consistent house style. Now, if you were to consistently bottle bitter Bushmills, because this is a bitter whiskey, you would actually restrict your appeal to the wider market, and that's no good when you need a certain high volume of sales. So it's fascinating with Knappogue Castle to get a kind of stripped down, as I said earlier, naked version of Bushmills. Quite elemental. So I'll start off with me tasting notes, smelling and tasting and marks and all the rest of it, and then I'll tell you a little bit more about this. When I first opened the bottle, I thought to myself, I'm not really going to enjoy this. I thought to myself, this is just a bit too extreme. It's certainly not what I was expecting. And what happened next is something that is experienced by an awful lot of whiskey drinkers, is that your first impression in opening a bottle can be quite particular. But you find as the bottle goes down, two things are happening. There is a slight oxygenation of oxidizing of the spirit itself, so it kind of goes from being quite uptight and perhaps a little aggressive to being softer, mellower and more accessible. Secondly, what's happening is that, particularly if you haven't tasted a whiskey before, your senses are not used to the particular arrangement of smell and taste, particularly taste. It can be a bit of a shock for the tongue and the mouth to taste something for the first time, and initial reaction, consciously or even perhaps subconsciously, is I don't like this. But as you have repeated number of small glasses, you start to get much more familiar with what's going on, and the senses adjust, and what you can have is a growing positive experience from what started out being slightly negative. And that certainly happened to me here, because you don't get that many seriously bitter whiskies. I mean, a good example would be single cask Old Pulteney's, about 16 to 17 years old. That can be a very bitter sort of lemony whiskey, and takes a bit of getting used to, although very nice, delicious stuff. But you don't tend to get a dominance of bitterness too often. It's a bit of a shock on first contact, because of that strong personality that you get with the flavour. But once it settles down, and importantly, once we settle down with our familiarity, then things start to get onto more of an even keel. Nose. Very much an even keel of green, grassy, grainy, dry malt, wood shavings. Very prominent wood sap, camphor, mild mint and mild spearmint. So you've got a wee combination of mints going on in the nose. Sour cream, butter, gentle confectionery egg, a gentle note of confectioner's custard, and eau de cologne. So a particularly dry, grassy nose with that sort of savoury note from the eau de cologne, and a little bit of soft, delicate and quite complex mintiness. Taste. And I recommend, actually, just a small drop of water. Not much. It is at 40%. And you don't actually want to lose that bitterness, because it's actually quite an engaging feature of this whiskey. I'd love to see more official Bushmills bottlings being a bit more aggressively assertive with their personality. Initially, quite soft, grassy, bittersweet barley sugar, and then that sour cream, lemon juice, rind, very particular rind note, grapefruit stroke lemon rind, wood shavings, so we're getting that wood note that was on the nose coming through in the flavour as well, brittle oak, greengage, crab apple, mint, lovage, which is a herb, rocket leaf, which is a salad, bitter salad, lettuce, bitter mint. And to add a little drop of water, and just a wee drop, will enhance a mild sweetness that's in the background that will steadily grow, and the bitterness, the assertive bitterness, will diminish slightly. Finish, sour oak, dry vanilla, wood juice and mature vegetal oak sap. So very consistent dram this, going from arrival, development and into the finish. Very different, And because of that, very enjoyable too. No doubt about it, this is very cleanly, professionally made spirit. It is. And what surprised me, and I wasn't expecting this, was to get such a refreshing version of an official bottling, which I know reasonably well. And it doesn't really necessarily excite me that much, because it's such an accessible, rounded, semi-sweet flavour. That's what you get. And with plenty of honey and vanilla, that's what you get with the official Bushmills. But this one, oh, is a whole different creature, no doubt about it. And, no, that's a, excuse me, I'm actually adding an additional mark, because the more I taste this, the more I'm enjoying it. There we go. Out of 100, and that is a malt mark, a triple distilled malt mark. There we go, lovely stuff. Old versions of Bushmills, by the way, are few and far between. There's a 21-year-old, I believe, still floating about, but a few years ago there was a 23-year-old, excellent stuff, and I believe at some point there may have been a 25-year-old. They tend to be quite expensive, unfortunately. You don't get with Bushmills, you know, much in the way of single cask versions, but perhaps it's something we'll see in the future. And you can actually see the connection with Auchentoshan, funnily enough, which is the closest Irish style distillery in Scotland to what I'm tasting. It's something that I've been going through the Irish whiskies, tasting them and getting more familiar with that style and personality range, that you can see that if you were in Scotland and you were looking for an Irish style whiskey, one of the first you'd be looking for is Auchentoshan, in particular the Valanch. But if you can't get the Valanch, the 12-year-old. Lovely stuff. Back to the bitterness. You've got to taste it to believe it. But there's quite a humorous way in which I can pass on the kind of the bitter note to yourselves, in that on YouTube, you just put a wee search in for baby's first pineapple. And it's absolutely hilarious seeing the little dribbly smiling munchkins sitting in their baby chair, full of enthusiasm for everything and anything, and being weaned on rusks, milk, and sweet breakfast cereal and all the rest of the things that babies get. And then they're getting their first taste of something which is really bitter. Now, a slice of lemon would be a bit cruel, but pineapple is just does the job. And you see I'll kind of give you a kind of taster for, excuse the pun, for what you'll find on these videos. A little baby going, and then they get the slice of pineapple, and all you see is, and it's the completely honest, sudden change in expression that so elegantly transposes just what proper real bitterness is. It's not to everybody's taste, but it's something that everybody should experience. I think that it'd be worth literally tasting a teaspoonful of vinegar to literally get a full load of sourness, to actually munch on a lemon peel, to get a big experience of bitterness to a teaspoonful of honey, to get that big experience of sweetness, and just consciously observe it, because so much of our tasting and smelling is done passively, instinctively, subconsciously even, that to address different, not specific flavours, but different types of influence and flavours, bitter, sour, acidic, sweet, salt, to actually do it in a concentrated form doesn't do any harm at all, and to observe that. So there we are, review done and dusted. One more review to go with the Irish Whiskey series. So in Whiskey Review 349, I will be reviewing a mystery whiskey from Ireland. I'm not going to tell you what it is. I really don't think it's really been reviewed online in any detail before. I don't even know what it tastes like yet, because it's going to be one of these whiskies that I actually open the bottle live in the Manx Bothy and pour a glass. And it's certainly not a whiskey you can buy, but easily. I mean, you could buy it at an auction, but I'm not going to give you any more spoilers. You're going to have to come along, yes, come along to the Manx Bothy in a few days' time for Whiskey Review 349 and see for yourselves what's going on. The conclusion, yes, the grand finale to this short series on Irish whiskies in the run-up to St. Patrick's Day. Thank you for watching, and steady as you go.